Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Praise you, Lord. Praise you, Lord. Father, we just ask that you place your loving arms around every listener of this radio show, Father. Father, we just ask you to just touch us and anoint every listener. Touch us, touch me and anoint me, touch Kenneth, touch Kathy, touch the people who are behind the scenes, coordinating things, Father God. We just ask for a spirit, an anointing of peace, supernatural peace, which passes all and passeth all understanding, to be on all of our hearts and minds, that we are anxious for nothing. We praise you, Father, for bringing us to this point this evening, to this day here on the 7th of April of 2013, Father God, and we count every day as a blessing. We praise you, Father, for every chance that we have to walk out in emboldened spirits and just reach out and touch people, to speak to them, and just be led to lead them to the kingdom of Jesus Christ. Lord God, we lift up the state of Israel. We see the winds of war brewing. We see the North Korean situation continuing to boil. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we ask you, please, Father God, to protect your people, to show yourself strong, that your Abrahamic covenants will be revealed across the world, that your people will know that our King, Jesus, is their King. Father, we just pray, we just lift up every single unsaved elect person out there, Father God, all the unsaved that are out there that are going to be in parts of the world that are affected. We lift up the South Koreans, Father. We lift up the Christians, the saints of South Korea, Father God, and we ask you to just surround them with a hedge of protection of holy fire to protect them, Father, that when those missiles rain down, not if, Father God, but when those missiles rain down, as you revealed through your servant, Dr. David O'Rourke, when those missiles rain down, Father God, that you protect your people. Father, if they are part of yours, if they are part of your predestined saints, your saved elect, Father God, if they are affected, Father, we know that it rains on the just and the unjust. And in the name of Jesus, we pray that you take them in peace with no pain. In the name of Jesus, that your people suffer no pain. In Jesus' name, we claim it. In the name of Jesus, thank you, Father. Father, we also pray that as these things start to boil out of control, as the missiles start to launch, that each person that is even beginning to understand where they should be in the kingdom finds their way to Jesus, hears the knock, that their ears are opened wide and they fall to their knees in repentance before your throne in the name of Jesus, Father. We pray that this is an opportunity to wake up the church in the name of Jesus. We pray that this is an opportunity to wake up the congregation in Jesus' name so that they understand they have to repent of their sins, that they cannot sit in the pews and send their way into heaven in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father. We praise your holy name. We thank you, Lord. Thank you for this electronic ecclesia. Thank you for this every opportunity that we have to gather together as an ecclesia, as a gathering of like-minded believers that are excited about the return of your Son, our King, people who are not just watchmen, but who are watching. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father, for waking us up. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, praise Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Praise you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. So it looks like the listening audience got a little inside peek into the Johnny Baptist. I don't know. I guess you wouldn't call it the EIB Golden Microphone headquarters. You'd call it the Tampa Bay Golden Microphone, or you know, whatever headquarters. Praise Jesus. But I guess we were able to defy physics this evening, and I'd like to say that I was telling the demons to get out of the house. I'd like to tell you all that praise Jesus. I was in the name of Jesus. Get out. In the name of Jesus, okay? But that's not what was happening. I'm having a three-dog night here at the Johnny Baptist house. Matter of fact, we'll play a little bit of this three-dog night tambala thing here. Praise God. Amen. So, all right. So anyway, that's... that's the song of the night whenever I have a three-dog night here at the house, praise Jesus. So, yeah, so anyway, we had the microphones muted, and evidently when I was telling the dogs to sit down, praise God, the sound waves decided they were going to defy the microphone mute and just go right through the sound console. So I guess that was a spiritual scolding that just had a way of exciting the electrons and moving past the mute button on the mic. What do you think there, Kenneth? You're the one with the PhD.
Hey, John, when I heard you say settle down, and I don't know if the listeners heard it, but it come through loud and clear on my headset.
It blasted right through the microphone. How did it do that? Kenneth. Stop that laughing.
You know, more importantly than that, bro, you are having a three-dog night. But you know what? That shofar, I love it because it reminds me that when the Lord himself will come down from heaven, there's going to be a commanding shout from the voice of the archangel. You know what I think that archangel is going to say? He's going to say to all the demonic host around this world, which is the kingdom right now of Lucifer, he's going to say, get away, move, our Lord's coming. And then you know what's going to happen, brother? There's going to be a trumpet call, what you prayed, and then we're going to hear a shout. And what I believe our Lord's going to say, he's going to say, arise, just like he said to Lazarus, and then the dead in Christ will rise first. And you know what's going to happen then, brother? We're going to be lifted up. It's going to be so glorious, brother. So, you know, you have your three-dog night, but I'm just hanging on to that shofar I just heard.
Oh, yeah, amen. Praise God. And, yes, we're back on track. All the doggies here at the Tampa Bay headquarters of Tribulation Now Radio are all nice and settled down. They finished their pig's ears, and they're no longer being unruly. Praise Jesus. So, hallelujah. All right, so we have an exciting show tonight. I'm not really sure if... Well, anyway, to get back on track, we have a really exciting show tonight. But first, I'd like to go ahead and bring forward some exciting announcements. All right? Praise God. Praise Jesus. And I just love that trumpet fanfare sound. And that's to announce, praise God, that this Wednesday on April the 10th, we'll be having Brother Stan Deo from Millennium Ark joining us. So that'll be real exciting. And we're going to pepper him. We're going to challenge him. You know, he tends to like to have the kind of an open microphone dynamic and just kind of let the Holy Spirit flow. So praise God for that. So I think he's going to find our line of questioning rather, you know, interesting. It's certainly going to be way far and more challenging, no doubt, than some of the other radio shows that he's visited lately, even coast to coast, I would suspect. Praise God. All right. And then also Ron Skiba. Praise Jesus for his work. His work is vast. We've had him on the radio show two other times, and he will be joining us on Sunday, April the 14th. Praise God. And then also Chris Putnam, the co-author of The Last Pope, Petrus Romanus, and also the co-author with Thomas Horn of the new book Exo Vaticana. Okay, Vaticana or whatever. All right, and he's going to be coming on Wednesday, April the 17th, to talk about that work, which is real exciting. Now, exciting. I tried to order the Exo Vaticana book on Kindle so I could get, you know, instant fulfillment and start hammering my way through it before the show, but unfortunately, it's not released on Kindle yet, so I'll have to wait for the book to arrive and try to do some Evelyn Wood speed reading stuff there. Anyway, it's real exciting. Absolutely blessed gentlemen joining us over the next three major shows. And then we'll also be doing some interesting discussions on the Open Sunday that week following Wednesday the 10th. And I'm just looking at the calendar here. So let's see, the 10th, the 14th, yeah, the 21st, we'll be debunking and discussing this what was the name of that fellow, Giovinotto guy? What was that guy's name there, Kenneth?
Oh, boy, John, that's a tongue twister. Did you hear when George Norrie tried to pronounce that thing? It's I can't even say it. Giovinotto. I mean, he's got like,
you know,
quite
natto,
a few.
Gnatto, it sounds like some kind of a pastry you'd run into in Little Italy in downtown Manhattan.
Yeah, I can't pronounce it. I mean, I was trying to count the syllables. You remember back in school when you had to put your hand under your chin and count the syllables? I was trying to count the syllables. I lost track after about five.
Your hand under your chin? We never did that in my high school. That must have been a Pennsylvania thing.
That was Sister Carmelita at the little Catholic school.
That baby cracks me up. I love that laughing baby. Praise God. Yeah, we have to, you know, we have to yuck it up and have a little bit of levity because a lot of the stuff we talk about is creepy. Praise God. Ecclesiastes 1:18. Anybody who knows the stuff that we know, that's a banner verse and arguably one that we'd want to be wearing on our T-shirts. Praise Jesus. All right, so here's the reason why we're doing this particular radio show on this particular night, praise Jesus, is because unless, you know, barring unforeseen circumstances, we were told by Brother Rick Wiles of True News that our, you know, Rapture Roundtable, Rapture/No Rapture, Roundtable discussion will be broadcast on True News either April the 8th or the 9th. So that would be tomorrow or Tuesday. Praise Jesus. So we're excited about that. We pray that everything goes fine with the transmission and the word gets out and people can, you know, discern and pray about the information that was presented. Now, on the eve of our anticipated or on the eve of the anticipated release of that show, I thought it would be kind of a treat. At least it is for me, because I think the most exciting event since the foundations of the earth, since the foundations of the universe, since Genesis 1:1, really, would be the event that we're talking about tonight. And there's reasons why the Lord, our Heavenly Father, doesn't, you know, there are so many people out there and they get into the bicker, back and forth. And there's like, you know, divisions in Christianity over this topic. And, you know, it's amazing, too, because one of the questions that people will ask is, you know, how come Jesus didn't come right out and say it? How come the Father didn't come right out and say it? Well, in fact, most of the most exciting things in the Scripture, the most, you know, fundamental, basic, entry-level salvation is pretty much right out in the open. So most readers of the New Testament are going to see the offer of eternal life if you're obedient and you give your life to the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Your Lord and Savior, not just your Savior. Amen? So praise God. So most people will see that, but the exciting stuff is the mysterious stuff, things like inheritance and rewards and things like that aren't really out in the open. And most Christianity, 95%+ arguably, doesn't know about inheritance and rewards. And it's a shame. 1 Corinthians 3:13-15, it talks about it. Galatians 5:19 infers it. Revelation, I think it's... when Jesus, what is the scripture, Kenneth, when Jesus says he comes with his rewards in his hands to give out to everyone according to their works? Anyway, Kenneth will find that, praise God. It's in like Revelation 20 or something like that. So, you know, inheritance from rewards, very, very mysterious, exciting. We're not all created equal in heaven. You are rewarded according to your work, believe it or not. So it's not, yes, you are saved by grace, but we are expected to through our obedience of Jesus Christ, we are expected to, do things because we're excited about the kingdom. You know, if you're familiar with Penn and Teller, Penn who said, who actually came out with a YouTube video, and I got it, Kenneth, God bless you, brother, and he came out with a YouTube video, and he said that, hey, I'm open to the world, I am an atheist, but I had a person on my team that was a Christian, and the man handed me a Bible, and he pursued me, and he said, Penn said that he... Penn Jillette said that he had the greatest amount of respect for this man. He said, this is an atheist saying this. He said, How much do you have to hate somebody to not tell them about eternal life if you truly believe it? Amen? Praise God. So, then you've got the rapture and once your spirit is open, once your eyes are open, once your heart is open, once you see it on the words just jump off the page and it becomes so obvious. It's everywhere. It's in Ezekiel 34. It's all over the place. Praise God. And Kenneth is pointing out, and behold, I come quickly with my reward. My reward is with me to give to every man according to his work. Okay, praise Jesus. That's Revelation 22. 12. Praise God. Okay, so anyway, we're going to help everybody understand not just the rapture scriptures that are in the Bible and talk about the principle of inference, understanding what the inferred meaning. Sometimes the inferred meaning of the scripture is far more powerful and abundant than the literal meaning. Isn't it fascinating how so many people can say, as in the days of Noah, means that Nephilim will come crawling out from under the bowels of the earth and eat all your dogs and cats? Really? That's what's called inferred meaning. Well, the literal meaning is that, as in the days of Noah, people given and taken in marriage. You're not going to be paying attention when Jesus comes. Bam, it's going to be like a snare. Praise God. All right, that's the literal meaning. The inferred meaning is the Nephilim might, crawl out from the caves or whatever, Allah, Tom, Horn, and Steve Quayle, or whatnot. Praise Jesus. So it's very important to be able to sense, to discern, to feel, to spiritually, with your sanctified imagination, with your sanctified emotions, to be able to extrapolate the inferred meaning of the scripture. And we're going to share with you why the Lord hides, he doesn't really hide, but he conceals these mysteries inside his scripture so that they're meant for those who love him with all their heart. Jesus said, the apostle said to Jesus, what is the greatest, commandment? And Jesus said, to love the Lord your God with all, with all your soul and your heart, with everything. We should love God so much that we're drawn to him. We're drawn to our Heavenly Father. We want to know more. And we don't want to have any predisposed belief systems. We want to be careful how we hear. Because we care so much. We long and we yearn to hear what the Lord wants to tell us. And when the Father feels that emotion, feels that spiritual yearning from inside of your heart, he reveals more and more mysteries to you. Praise Jesus. Kenneth?
He really does, John, because we worship God in spirit and in truth. And it's just so amazing. He knows, you can say all the right words, you can do all the right things, but if your heart isn't right with him, he knows, he sees right through it. So quit trying to fake it. When I finally realized that, praise Jesus, he just opened my eyes to that truth, and you know what? It's like the lights came on. It's like, I can't fool him. I can't pull one over on the Most High God. And when I fell to my knees and finally realized that I had to start being honest, most importantly, with myself and quit trying to play games, brother? He just opened. He just opened the heavens to me, and praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Oh, yeah, amen. We don't even have enough time on this radio show for me to give you my testimony. And boy, oh boy, what a roller coaster ride that was. Again, I was raised as a no-rapture person. We dug cellars. We got backhoes. We were growing vegetables. We moved out onto a farm. We raised chickens. We were putting things on ice. We were preparing for the Great Tribulation. Amen. I mean, we were, my family was raised as, no-rapture people. So my metamorphosis, if you will, my spiritual change of heart came, over time with a lot of tears. Praise God, and it's very exciting. Let's take a listen to this clip. I love this clip. This is, it's all about the rapture.
Are we there yet?
No.
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 Are we there yet?
You little... we're there.
Woohoo!
Praise Jesus. Hallelujah. So, folks, again, isn't it fascinating? I'm just going to mention this real quick. It is in the show notes. So if you go to www.tribulation-now.net, okay, there you can download the show notes. Now, sometimes it takes us a little while to get them up there. Or you can, you know, if you struggle on that website, no problem. You can always email me at jbaptist777@gmail.com, and I can send you the show notes. They have all these scriptures and everything we're going to be talking about tonight. Okay, we do have a lot of material. Now, again, reach out to get those scriptures. Now, here's the thing. What I find really amazing. I struggle to understand how people who don't believe in the rapture, I don't understand why when the Lord puts it right in their hands, that they still turn away from it. I really don't understand it because it's such a wonderful gift. I don't know if it's because they've come out and they've spoken with big microphones across the world for many years saying that they don't believe it and they're embarrassed. I really don't understand that. I will say that, you know, here, you know, whenever we make a mistake or we think, you know, we have to digress, we're very quick to eat our gummy crows, especially Kenneth. Right, Kenneth? Kenneth.
You.
Kenneth.
You betcha, John. Hey, you know what?
Hey, save me a couple, will you?
Hey, you know what? You know what, bro? More important even than that is a lot of those people have such a mean spirit about them. And I know what I see in the scriptures. And we're going to cover some of that tonight. And if the listeners catch the show on True News, they're going to hear some of it. I mean, it is what it is. I love that saying. It is what it is. It's there. And, you know, Jesus talked about parables, and I'm hoping we can get in a little bit of that tonight. He showed me that. And there was a very clear part in his ministry where he stopped speaking in black and white and started speaking in parables. And I hope we can get into why he did that tonight. But I see such a mean spirit in some of those people that naysay all this, and I just pray for them every day.
Yeah, I would think that, you know, it would be – why would anybody want their fellow Christians to suffer if they didn't have to? Wouldn't it be – if you have the agape love of Jesus in your heart, if you look at a hungry homeless person and it makes you cry, if you have the real love of Jesus in your heart, then why wouldn't you search the scripture hungrily, hoping that there was a rescue mission? Why would you want your fellow Christians and their families and their babies and their children to suffer worse than Nazi Germany? I don't understand that. So anyway, I'm going to read this. Get your houses in order. This is a Wings of Prophecy from Glenda Lomax. Again, the reason why I'm going to read this again is because so many of the, quote, Watchmen websites out there and Watchmen radio shows have been historically publishing all of Glenda Lomax's prophecies. But this is the very first one. It's like the Lord snuck one in. He snuck one in by going through Glenda. She's never had one like this before. And out of the clear blue sky, Glenda Lomax comes out with this word from the Lord. My people, the end times are upon you. The end of all things is approaching. And you must now get your houses in order, for you will all be coming home. You must now be ready to leave the earth at any time. Folks, the reason why this is clearly about the rapture, absolutely about the rapture, is because if you're a there's a lot of different belief systems regarding the rapture, timing wise. Okay, so some people embrace what the vast majority of the people out there believe that it's pre-tribulation. Now, why that becomes a little bit cloudy and a bit of a problem. And Chuck Missler, if you're listening, just put your hands over your ears right now and go la, 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 la. But the reason why it becomes a problem is because pre-trib rapture people believe that they're going to be raptured before right at the cusp of Daniel's 70th week. Okay, so they believe they're going to be raptured off the earth at the beginning of the last 7 years. And that's why they're called pre-tribulation period rapture people. But that philosophy, belief system, whatever, is riddled with holes. It just doesn't match what the Bible says. As a matter of fact, the Bible doesn't even define a tribulation period at all. It only refers to one tribulation, and that's the Great Tribulation, reference Revelation 2, verse 22. Praise Jesus. Okay, that's where the Church of Thyatira is cast into the Great Tribulation because she fails to repent. The Great Tribulation lasts 3.5 years, or 1,260 days, or 42 months, or times and half a time, or one prophetic day, or the day of the Lord, which is the whole Great Tribulation, which starts out with the day of the Lord and then moves on. So that day of the Lord actually goes for the whole 3.5 years. And then or the hour of trial. And there's confirmations of each one of these metaphorical time periods, these prophetic references. Okay, praise Jesus. And it's very exciting. So if you look at Proverbs 25:2, and I think this is really important to just go ahead and bring this out here, and let me go ahead and bring this up. I want to make sure I read this verbatim, all right? In Proverbs 25:2, this particular verse is the secret to understanding very, very much of what we'll be talking about this evening, okay? It is the glory of God to conceal a matter, but the glory of kings is to search out a matter. Okay? Praise Jesus. Now let's go back and take another look at that. It is the glory of God to conceal a matter. Really? Really? Get it? You see, the Father wants us to be so fascinated and intrigued and so totally in love with Him and believe in Him and trust in Him and know that if we're practicing righteousness that He's going to come for His bride. He wants us to yearn and long for His Son. And there are so many who are borderline, even teachers and preachers and pastors and people with radio shows and all sorts of folks out there don't really feel the passion and the love. And when they, if conceal, think about that word, It's God's glory. It's his glory to concealeth a matter. He hides things on purpose. He wants us to want him so bad that we read it over and over, and we pray and we seek and we pray and we seek until, and then boom, the Lord gives it to us in a bonanza, and then there's no turning back. Once those doors start to open and the Father starts to reveal the mysteries of the Scripture to you, your yearning for more of that blessing, it just overcomes you. It just changes you. And it's just absolutely amazing. And again, it's the glory of kings to search out the matter. So those of us who love our King, who love our Heavenly Father with all of our hearts and souls, it's our glory to search it out. And that's what we're going to do tonight. Now look, here's Glenda Lomax's prophecy. Remember, the Great Tribulation, that's the time of wrath. That's the really, really ugly period of 3.5 years. It's the last 3.5 years. It's a time like no other time on the earth. Read Daniel 12. It pretty much spells it right out. As a matter of fact, I'll read that to you. Praise Jesus. It says, "And at that time Michael shall stand up, the great prince who stands watch over the sons of your people, and there should be a time of trouble such as never was since there was a nation, even to that time. And at that time your people shall be delivered." Wow. Praise God. At that time. See, that's a hint of the rapture, folks, right there in Daniel 12. See, once your heart is open to it, you see it everywhere. It's just such a blessing. But anyway, so here's Glenda Lomax, through the voice of the Lord, speaking through here for the first time. "My people, the end times are upon you. The end of all things is approaching, and you must now get your houses in order, for you will all be coming home. You must now be ready to leave the earth at any time. Order your houses thus, as though you knew you would be leaving now. Instruct those who may be left behind." Did you hear that? Instruct those who may be left behind. Some of you are scheduled to be leaving very soon, and you know it not. And you have not made ready, either in your spirits or your houses. You must understand the seriousness of the times that you live in. Do you not see the grave threats abounding in the world around you? Do you not see the signs foretold in my holy word for these times? Earthquakes and famines are coming that are like nothing you have ever seen. Plagues the world knows nothing of. Prepare your houses, your minds, and your spirits as though you are leaving tomorrow. Then watch and pray for my son's soon return. Wow. That is powerful. And you know what's so sad is I don't think that a lot of these folks who've been putting Glenda Lomax's prophecies on their websites put this one up. This is a blessing to those of us who are watching, because we know we're leaving. Praise Jesus. Kenneth?
Yeah, John, we do know. We know that we know, like they say. And, you know, a lot of these people that bash this this understanding of God's word, they'll say things like, well, you know, Christians in the past have suffered. Christians in the past have been persecuted, and that's all true. And that's happening today in China. Even here in the United States, there are those sorts of things happening. But you know what? No one has ever, except Jesus Christ on that cross, has faced the wrath of God. And that's what we're talking about. That's what we'll be spared from, the wrath of God. Sure, there's suffering, there's persecution, there always has been, there always will be, and there is tribulation, and that means the trying of our faith, and we all go through tribulations of one sort or another, but we're talking about being spared from the very wrath of the Most High God.
Oh, amen, and you know, you can split hairs, which believe you me, those who want to disprove the rapture. You know, again, I'm a pre-wrath rapture of the church person. As a matter of fact, anybody who wants to split hairs about the scriptures, I highly, highly recommend that you consider investing in the book by Marvin Rosenthal, The Pre-Wrath Rapture of the Church. Now, Mr. Rosenthal gave up his career. Now, he's still out there, praise Jesus for him, doing wonderful work. But Mr. Rosenthal had to step down as the director of the largest pre-trib rapture organization in the world, because the Lord revealed to him that it's not pre-trib, it's pre-wrath. Praise God. And wow, the first chapter or two of that book will blow your mind. Praise Jesus. Because when you see what this man went through, it was awful. The people on the board of directors of that organization came to him in private, okay, the largest pre-trib rapture organization in the world, and many of them, not all of them, but several of them came to him in private and said, "We want to support you, brother Rosenthal, but you know, we my father's father was pre-trib, my grandmother's grandmother was pre-trib. We have a line of pre-trib pastors in my family that go back for four generations or whatever," and they just couldn't do it. It wasn't because they didn't believe it was pre-wrath. It was because they couldn't suffer the humility, or they couldn't humble themselves, and you know, it was embarrassing to them. Can you imagine that? For that reason alone, I highly recommend this book, The Pre-Wrath Rapture of the Church. Praise God. Matter of fact, I found out about this from listening to Chuck Misler's teaching on the rapture. So praise God for Brother Misler for at least being, you know, open-minded enough to even mention it on his teaching. Praise God. So and it says in 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 9, we are not appointed to wrath. Now, check this out. Some people split hairs and they go, well, you know, it says in Revelation, you know, chapter 6, verse 17, that the day of the Lord's wrath has come. And so that marks the beginning of the wrath. Well, yes, it does. And you know, from an official scriptural standpoint, it does. So it implies, and I believe that this is probably true, it implies that potentially the sixth seal and the sudden destruction of 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 potentially happen all at one time. Now, there's a lot of folks out there that go, oh, no, that's not true. You know, first you got to have the first seal and then the second seal. And then you've got these people that believe that the trumpets overlay the bowl judgments and they're not two different series of events, but they're one and the same. But, you know, it's crazy. And then you've got the preterists. Holy cow. Like Dr. Walter Weiss, who's an amazing teacher. Dr. Weiss is a fantastic teacher. But then he gets into this preteristic teaching where he believes that absolutely everything in Revelation happened 200-400 years ago, pretty much. And I'm like, you know, no, that's not how it works. So anyway, so the sudden destruction in 1 Thessalonians 5 is the marker. It is the official marker in my personal belief. I could be wrong. You know, like I said, I've got my crows right here and handy, but it is my personal belief that the sudden destruction marks the point of the rapture. The sudden destruction marks the point of God's wrath. That doesn't mean that he can't perform an act of wrath. He had wrath back in the past. He had wrath at Sodom, on Sodom and Gomorrah. He had wrath when the flood of Noah. All throughout history, the Lord, our Heavenly Father, has had periods of wrath. Okay, so to suggest that there's only one point of wrath, I think might be folly. Okay, so we know that all hell breaks loose at the sudden destruction in 1 Thessalonians 5, and it says, and they shall not escape. There will be peace and safety, and they shall not escape. Get it? That's a clearly inferred meaning. We will escape. Get it? You have to infer the obvious. Praise God. It's so exciting. I just don't understand how anybody can read that and not see it. It's so glorious. Praise Jesus. Kenneth?
It is glorious, John. It truly is. And as these scriptures start to open up, I'm just awed. I just stand there in awe. And, you know, there's always a new understanding tomorrow. So I do have my gummy crows right here, John. Right here. Those are my gummy crows. And they're ready to go at any moment. You know, I'm ready to pop one in my mouth.
Hey, some of them got out of the box. Praise Jesus. So, okay, so now we're going to go ahead and hit some of these apocalyptic end of the world warning sign headlines, warning sudden destruction alert type headlines. Praise Jesus. It's very exciting. And there's a lot of them. This North Korea thing is about to take off. Praise God. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Final sign preventing the second coming of Jesus. This is by a guy by the name of Joe Kovacs, and it was published on WorldNet Daily as an exclusive article. And this individual makes a claim that millions of Christians worldwide are presently awaiting the return of Jesus to earth, personally administering the kingdom of God. And he goes on to say, basically, the claim here is that they're expecting them to build a temple in Israel, and that Jesus can't come back for the bride until that temple is built. Okay, and unfortunately, they base that on some scriptures, quite a few, that I believe with all my heart that they're completely missing the point on. Praise God. For example, I'll read one of them. Therefore, when you see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet standing in the holy place, let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. Stop. That's Matthew 24, verse 15. Now, the problem here is that they're taking it a little too much at face value. They're not really getting it. Okay, and I didn't get it either. For 30 plus years, I was like, oh yeah, the holy place, Daniel the prophet standing in Jerusalem, it's Jerusalem. And folks, we saw when Obama went over to his visit to Jerusalem on March the 20th, so many people were just going, oh, he's going to be standing in the holy place. He's going to be in Jerusalem. He's going to be in Jerusalem. So you had folks that were kind of bending the meaning a little bit to mean Jerusalem as opposed to the new or third Solomon's temple, which so many believe is going to be built. All right? Let's take another look at that verse. Praise God. Therefore, when you see the abomination of desolation, that would be Barack Hussein Obama, spoken of by Daniel the prophet, standing in the holy place. Now, here's the catch. Praise Jesus. In parenthesis, it says, whoever reads, comma, let him understand. See, that is the Bible warning us that you cannot take those words at face value. There's a hidden mystery, an underlying hidden lines upon lines, precepts upon precepts, here a little, there a little, meaning that you got to look for. The holy place is the temple body. The abomination of desolation will be the manifestation of Lucifer in the body of a human. That is the holy place. It's not the third Solomon's temple, folks. Praise Jesus. Hallelujah. That is very exciting. And folks, I'm sorry, but I have to absolutely disagree with this brother at WorldNet Daily that we have to have a third temple or the Solomon's temple in Jerusalem. Kenneth?
Amen, John. You know, 2 points here. First, the prophet Samuel in 2 Samuel chapter 7, verses 5 and 6, and then verse 12, and here's the key. You know, he was talking to King David, and he was prophesying in the first two verses, 5 and 6, about his son Solomon building the temple, okay? And then in verse 12 he says, and when thy days be filled, thou shalt sleep with the fathers, and I shall set up thy seed after thee, which shall proceed out of thy bowels, and I will establish his kingdom. There he's talking about a temple not built by hands and with stone. And the first was Jesus. And then Jesus showed us that that was going to now be the mystery of the ages revealed. Christ in us, the hope of glory. And then I love how Paul sums it up in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 16. He says, you know, in what agreement has the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God. As God hath said, I will dwell in them and walk in them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Praise Jesus, brother.
Oh, yeah. Amen. It's so exciting. Praise Jesus. And Jack Van Impe, thumbs up, two thumbs up for you, Brother Jack Vianant, because he's been telling people we have prophetically met all the requirements for Jesus to come and get the bride. Praise God. So he's absolutely on top of it. God bless that man. I love him. When I was 9 years old, maybe 10 years old, in Hummelstown, Pennsylvania, I sat there on my bed downstairs in the basement. I had a little bedroom down there, and I listened to my 33.5 LP record album from Jack Van Impe entitled The Gog and Magog Invasion. Praise Jesus. All right, so, hey, I'm dating myself there, but praise God. You know, I'm so happy when I see folks that I learned so much from know that we've met all the prophetic markers. So praise Jesus for that. That is exciting. All right, now here is another headline. This is amazing. Now, you probably have seen this already. I assume maybe you have. It's big news. Big, big, big. Okay, huge. Humongous, as Prophet Dr. David O'Rourke would say. Humongous. Okay, 1 in 4 Americans think Obama may be the Antichrist, survey says. I mean, did you hear that? Okay, I'm going to read that again. 1 in 4 Americans think Obama may be the Antichrist, survey says. Now, this was published by The Guardian. It was also published on, it was on Reuters. It came out. It was on Fox News. I heard that O'Reilly even mentioned it. I don't know how many places on the mainstream media global news outlet that actually published this information. And folks, so when I first saw this, I was like, get out. 1 in 4? Are you kidding me? And then I read it, and I was like, okay, the survey, which was conducted by the Public Policy Polling, okay, the PPP, Public Policy Polling Organization, sampled American voters about the number of conspiracy theories, phrasing the question in eye-catching language that will have the country's educators banging their heads on their desk. The study revealed that 13% of respondents thought Obama was the Antichrist, while another 13% were not sure, and so were at least appeared to be open to the possibility that he might be. Some 73% of the people were able to say outright that they did not think Obama was the Antichrist. Okay, so basically 3/4 said they don't think he was, and 25% believe that he is. That is absolutely amazing. So if you have any, think about this. If Jesus comes like for his bride, okay, who is without spot or wrinkle or any such thing. Ephesians 5:27. That's the key. Not everybody is getting raptured. Okay? If you can love Jesus and still have sin in your life and not get raptured. Okay? So I've been pleading with people on this show, virtually every single show, get the sin out of your life. You know what it is most of the time. You should, okay? And we cover this information. You can go to tribulation-now.org, and in the black banner area at the top, you can click on the page. There's an article there entitled Being Holy. Okay, and you can read that. It shows you the scriptures. It shows you, you got to get yourself right. You got to purify your heart. Time is of the essence. Now is the time. If 1 in 4 Americans actually believe that Obama may be the Antichrist, then we are hitting a point in time that we're about to cross the line that it can no longer be as in the times of Noah, they will be giving and taking in marriage. Because the population of the world is waking up, and they can't. They can't fully awaken, because if they do, Jesus can't come like a snare. He can't come like a thief in the night. He can't surprise everybody. Therefore, we are right there. We don't know, exactly when, but we're right there. Praise Jesus. Kenneth?
You know, John, that's so true. There's going to be a secret, a sudden, like a thief in the night. I mean, that's the best way to put it. And if people wake up, it's not going to be as a thief in the night. And I just love those scriptures that talk to us that way. You know, don't be caught asleep. Don't be caught drunk. You know, they're talking about believers who may be sleeping and people in the world who are out there, you know, just intoxicated with the ways of the world. And then there's that whole other series of scriptures that talk about him coming in great glory. Well, we've got to be talking about two things, like we said. So, you know, it has to happen suddenly and it has to happen soon because people are waking up.
Yeah, amen. Praise God. And, you know, you could make the argument that, of course, people are going to wake up. And we pray every single show, virtually every show, we try to, you know, add in some prayer for the unsaved elect, some prayer for people who aren't awake, some, prayer for people who are sitting in the pews that are sinning their way, that think they're going to make it into heaven while they're still living in sin. Wow. Praise God. So I got to tell you this. This is the Lord speaks to people in different ways, in many different ways. And I had something happen to me that brought tears to my eyes, and I'm just going to share it with you. But it's kind of like multi-impact. I don't know how to quite explain it. But here's what happened. Okay. So I believe it was Saturday. Might have been Saturday. Might have been Friday evening. I can't remember. No, I think it was Saturday. But anyway, I decided I was going to go around 4:30 p.m., 5 o'clock p.m., give or take. I decided I was going to go down and get some Thai food at one of the local Thai restaurants right down the road from my house. Praise God. And so I jumped in my car, and I headed down there. And when I drove up, it was right before 5, about 4:30, 5, something like that. And the time was important because the restaurant should have been open. When I pulled my car up to the front of the restaurant and parked it there and got out, I saw a man sitting, obviously a homeless man, sitting to the side, to the left side of the opening of the restaurant, to the entrance, and he looked very sad. Very sad. And there was some broken glass beside him. It looked like he was frustrated. He might have broken some glass. I don't know. But he was not happy. And I walked over to the door of the restaurant, and I pulled on the door, and it wasn't open, which was very odd. And I turned back toward my car, and I looked again at this man, and I walked over to him, and I said to him, I said, "How you doing, brother?" And he goes, "Oh, you know," and you could tell he had a little bit to drink. And I said, "Here," I said, I gave him a little bit of money, and I said, "Here, brother, here's some money for some food." And I said, "Do you mind if I pray with you?" And he looked up at me and he said, "I would love it if you pray with me." And I held his hand and I put my arm on his shoulder, and I said a prayer with him. And while I was saying that prayer with him, he broke in on his own into the Lord's Prayer. And he said, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven." And as he said that, I was tearing up and saying it with him. He looked at me. He looked down into the hand, into his hand, where he had garbled up the money I gave him. And he looked back up at me with tears in his eyes, and he said, "Sir," he goes, "that prayer meant more to me than this money could ever mean." And I just was crying. It was just a powerful moment in my life. And I went back home. But this is where it gets really interesting. I mean, that was powerful enough. But when I got back home, I sat down in front of my computer and I checked my email, and I received an email from Sister Kathy. And it was she sent me a web link from a person who goes by the, you know, pen name VR2 from the 4th of April, Revelation of Jesus. And the person, it's a letter on five doves, and the person is pointing out that the word VR2, hold on a second, praise Jesus. I got to correct some dogs. Hallelujah. Hey, Kenneth, take over the radio show console while I deal with a puppy dog real quick.
Okay. You know, when Johnny was talking there about what he did with that man, it reminded me of something that Paul taught us over in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. And he was talking about love. And when John was talking about that man and what he did, there was a compassion that moved through him. And it really is the love of God, which all of our relationships ought to be built on. And it just reminded me of what Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 4, where he said, love is kind. You know, what John demonstrated there was the heart of a servant. And what Paul tells us over in Philippians chapter 2, verse 5 through 7, we're to take on that same heart. So that's what I got out of that, Johnny, and I know you're back, so praise Jesus. Here's the console, brother.
Yeah, praise God. Hallelujah. I love doggies. I love doggies. Yes, I do. Oh, my goodness. Yeah, I'm babysitting dogs tonight. Wouldn't you know it? Praise God. I just love them. Hey, if you want to see a picture of them, just email me at jbaptist777@gmail.com. I'll send you a picture of the dogs. God love them. But anyway, so I get back from this prayer and the tears and this homeless man breaking into the Lord's Prayer, and I open up my email, and Kathy sends me this revelation of Jesus from five doves, and this fellow is pointing out that he believes, he's right, that the word deliver us from evil is the same word used for the rapture. At least that's what this fellow was implying. But right or wrong, that's really kind of beside the point. What the beauty of this of the Lord speaking to me is, you know, and this is just hard to convey because it's a personal thing, but I struggle on a daily basis with how long we've been here. I struggle with the delays associated with the heavenly office of God. I felt like we should have been evacuated off of this alien demon infested rock a long time ago. Okay, so it's really hard for me to wait upon the Lord with a good, happy heart, you know, and so I'm always on this roller coaster ride, suffering the Ecclesiastes 1:18 problem, and so the Lord touches me. He reaches out and he causes impossible coincidences to occur. He knows that I seek ye first the kingdom and the Lord's righteousness, and then all these things will be given unto me. He knows that that's all I care about is serving him. And because of that, the Lord will give you these little gifts, and he will cause these impossible coincidences to occur. So what a blessing that someone, within minutes of this homeless gentleman crying, both of us crying together over the Lord's Prayer, and within minutes of that occurring, I receive an email from somebody on Five Doves claiming that the same word used in the Lord's Prayer for deliver us from the evil one is ultimately the same word used for the catching up or the rapture of the bride. Praise God. And that was, I just bawled my eyes out. That's how the Lord speaks to me. It's very exciting. Praise Jesus. Kenneth?
You know, John, I love how Curry Blake put it when I took one of his spiritual warfare training sessions. He said, when the Lord moves on you like that, everybody's wanting to know, like, well, how can I do the Lord's will? When the Lord moves on you like that, that compassion doesn't come from inside us. That's the Lord. That's the Most High God kind of like channeling right into you, spirit by spirit. Like we said earlier in the show, we worship God in spirit and in truth. Well, he speaks to you that way, too, through your spirit. So when you move like that, you're like, you're walking in the fullness of the Holy Spirit. The Lord's working through you, and it's so exciting to see those things and hear those testimonies. So praise the Lord, brother.
Amen. And I just got an email. Believe it or not, folks, I just got an email. God bless you. I saw that just come in, asking for a picture of the doggies. Hallelujah. Yeah. Amen. If you want to see a picture, you know, I'm more than happy. You know, I know that sometimes, you know, when we're doing the radio show, we tend to be a little, you know, we're just voices over the internet. And it's nice to kind of have a personal touch there and to get to know each other, you know, and fellowship. Praise God. Okay. So in the show notes on page 18 of 100, praise God, I have a section subtitled Backfire. Praise God. Okay, now why did I subtitle this little discussion right here, Backfire? Why did I call it Backfire? Well, let me explain it to you. First, I'm going to bring forward the scripture. The scripture is John 16, verse 2. I'm going to read it to you. And Jesus says, these things I've spoken to you that you should not be made to stumble. They will put you out of the synagogues. Yes, the time is coming that whoever kills you will think that he offers God a service. And these things they will do to you because they have not known the Father nor me. But these things I have told you that when the time comes, you maybe remember that I told you of them. Now, there's a lot of implied meaning here. But I'm just going to cut to the chase. If you have the love and the humility and the fear of God and the agape love of Jesus in your heart, and it just permeates through you, and you empathize and you feel other people's pain, and you long to help them, if you've reached that part in your sanctification process and your born again DNA change process, praise God, hopefully you have, then you will understand what that scripture means. What that scripture means is that people who really have the love of Jesus in them, they don't point fingers at other people and call them names, ever. Okay, they don't, you know, they're not accusatory. Hey, get that guy, burn him at the stake, burn him at the stake. He's a foul. He's a. You know, that isn't the love of Jesus. And as Jesus said, the people who do those kinds of things, they don't know the Father nor me. They don't have the love of Jesus in their heart. They haven't transformed yet. Doesn't mean that the Father won't use those people. The Father will use people for the benefit of the greater good of the kingdom, even though the person isn't meeting the requirements. And you can find that if you search on John Mulindy, M-U-L-I-N-D-E, John Mulindy, IHOP, I-H-O-P, on YouTube. You will hear the testimony of a fantastic faith healer, a leader of a big ministry in South Africa, who was told by the Lord that he would not be raptured, because the Lord saw that he was lusting after women in his heart. Praise Jesus. So, why I bring this forward is because we have to keep ourselves in check. Everything should be driven out of love. Okay, so I'm just bringing this to your attention. This is an innocent thing, but you need to know about it. Okay, there's a person, and God bless him, out there that's put up a YouTube video, and he's talking about shocking, this is the title of the YouTube, Shocking Origins, Church Steeples or Pagan Obelisks. Okay, and he points out that so many of the church steeples and stuff in the buildings, you know, are occult. Now, that's fine. This is part of the waking up process for people who are beginning to see with a new set of eyes. Kenneth refers to it as the veils, and he can talk about that in a second. But the veils of our eyes are opened up. We first, you know, many of us, we find out that 9/11 was 10 tons of super nano thermite, that it was brought down by the evil cabal, as it were. You know, the buildings were controlled demolition, that we were sucker punched, that a lot of the things are orchestrated here on the earth by Lucifer's minions. And then you start to wake up and you start to see things. You might get yourself a book written by Tex Mars, like Codex Magica or Mysteries, the Mysterious Monuments. Okay, and then you start to see all the symbolism everywhere. Then you move to the next level and you see that there are alien heads everywhere. That the Toyota car, that the automotive industry has alien heads. And then you might listen to Doc Marquis and CBS and NBC, and the pyramids are everywhere. Amen? All right. Well, the reason I'm bringing this up is because this is a little scary, because even though what this brother is telling people is true, that the architectures of the world, not just the churches, of the world, are full of occult symbols, the implication is the church is evil. Now, that's not necessarily what he's saying, but the problem that we have here is when you communicate this, it's very difficult to separate it and to help people who you're trying to teach understand that the people who architected the building were not necessarily, you know, just because they built a steeple onto the church doesn't mean that the pastor of that church is a bad person or worships the devil. So you have to be careful when you present this information. Why? Well, here's why. Praise Jesus. WorldNet Daily exclusive. Military warned that evangelical Christians are the number one threat, to the United States regarding evidently terrorism and such like that in the future. Okay, listen to this. Soldiers in the United States military have been told in a training briefing that evangelical Christians are the number one extremist threat to America, ahead of groups like the Muslim Brotherhood, KKK, Nation of Islam, Al-Qaeda, Hamas, and others. Men and women of faith who have served the Army faithfully for centuries shouldn't be likened to those who have regularly threatened the peace and security of the United States, said Colonel retired Ron Cruz, executive director of the Chaplain Alliance for the Religious Liberty. It is dishonorable for any U.S. military entity to allow this type of wrongheaded characterization. So there's an outcry regarding this. But in the show notes on page 19, okay, Brother Larry sent this in, and sure enough, there's a slide from the actual presentation that's leaked out, and at the very top of that list of threats is evangelical Christianity. Now, connect the dots, folks. On one side, you've got people out there trying to do good, pointing to the churches, saying the steeples are occult, saying that there's an evil eye on the church and that the church is evil. And then on the other side, you have the evil cabal, the shapeshifters, the dark side, the perfectly possessed, that are out there leveraging that and putting evangelical Christianity at the top. We are being set up. Anyone who is left behind, I feel for you. I am so scared for the people that are left behind. I pray so fervently because it is going to be so unspeakably horrible. Kenneth?
Wow, John, you know, there's so much stuff there. A couple points. You were talking about what the love of Christ in us really means. John said in verse 6 of 1 Corinthians 13, it rejoices not in iniquity. That means we don't go around when somebody maybe slips up or says something. I'm not even talking about sin here, but, you know, like that pastor that puts a steeple on his church and doesn't really know what it is. You don't go around doing that. You don't go around bashing him and calling him some kind of Illuminati conspirator. He maybe didn't know. He may be ignorant. So before we say anything bad about somebody, we ought to look at 3 points, you know. Is what we're going to say true, okay? Do we absolutely certainly know that it's true? And even if it's true, is it necessary to say it right now? Is it going to be of some edifying effect? Is it going to build up the body? Some things true are better left unsaid, you know. And then finally, if you must say it, can you say it with love and kindness? So just ask yourself that before you do it. But I see so many people out on the Internet. You know, I always used to be like this, so I know that. But they just want to let everybody know what they know. So they go out and they start bashing people that may be just doing some of this stuff out of ignorance. So that was the first point. The second point, brother, and this is so powerful. There's a guy out there. He's a pastor, and he's a really cool guy. I've read some of his books. He wrote this book called Pagan Christianity. And if the listeners want to understand how some of this stuff got into the church, this Frank Viola does a wonderful job just really explaining it in such a kind and loving tone. He just opens it up, and he explains it to you. So I'll post it in the chat room, but you know what? There's a lot of people that love Jesus out there that are just ignorant on these things and don't understand, and we shouldn't be bashing them.
Well, amen. As a matter of fact, I would take it even up a notch from there. I would submit that if you don't have anything nice to say, don't say anything at all. Period.
Amen, brother.
Period. Praise Jesus. As a matter of fact, that's the only way to be safe. That's the only way to be safe, because how do you know you're right? You might be wrong. I have been corrected by God before. And believe you me, I remember each one of those times like it was yesterday. Oh, yeah. Praise Jesus. Okay, so here's a thought. Was the 188-day cycle a miss? Okay, so we know about Planet X moving through the solar system and all that, and we could do an entire show on just the Planet X dynamic. But the 188-day cycle, was it a total miss? Okay, you know, and so just to let folks know, what is the 188-day cycle? So if for those of you who do not know what that is, arguably the planet X, as it's been moving, or its various satellites have been moving through our solar system, there have been alignment points that are being tracked by various people. And this has been espoused by a lot of different folks. One of the leaders, or I won't call him a leader, but I will say that one of the people who has a lot of data in this regard is referred to as Terrell03 on the internet. And he's a pretty smart guy. Don't agree with, you know, a lot of stuff he says, but anyway, amen. So here's the thing. There's been a lot of pastors and other people, Christians, that have espoused this 188-day cycle as well, because it's been thus far very trustworthy. So we were anticipating possibly possibly a big earthquake event at the end of March, at the beginning of April. Now, all we got was that Kenneth, what was it, a 7.2 or something in Indonesia a couple days ago?
Yeah, you know, John, I think it was around 7, but I don't have that number for sure.
Okay. All right. Amen. So so we had that. Some may claim that particular event was an indication, you know, or caused by the alignment of this black star or, Planet X destroyer, whatever you want to call it, nemesis. All right. So, again, we're watching to see, you know, it is our belief, you know, just based on the prophecies that we've been tracking over a year now, some of them longer, that, you know, there is going to be a California megaquake. We've covered that on prior shows. We read to you the Joe Brandt dream from the 30s. It was also covered in the book The Vision by David Wilkerson in 1973, you know, and many, many other people, including the prophet Dr. David Aurora, Elvia Zapata, Chu Thomas, the list goes on and on, praise God. So, you know, we believe that there's going to be a big, humongous, gigantic earthquake that's going to occur, and it's going to be global in scope and affect many different countries, but one of the most heavily devastated parts of the world will be California, praise God. And so, you know, again, I'm just bringing out, you know, what happened to the 188-day alignment dynamic of this Planet X Nibiru thing moving through our solar system. You know, we don't know. Okay, so, and I will say that there are those out there that are, you know, suggesting that because this event did not occur, this mega quake event, or, you know, arguably a 9, an 8, or a 9 or higher, did not occur on this particular cycle, that could be a really bad thing, because it means that the thing is speeding up, it's no longer on the same trajectory, they've lost track of it, and that potentially the next event that this thing causes is going to be, well, really cataclysmic. So what do we know? We know that, you know, we've got the three final signs that were brought forward by Brother L.V. Zapata. He referred to the California quake, an earthquake in the northeastern part of the United States, and the war with Israel as the three final signs prior to the rapture. Dr. David O'Rourke has said in many of his teachings that the Lord told him that the rapture will happen before the Iran/Israel war breaks out. Okay, praise God. And also, Dr. David O'Rourke saw the missiles coming down from North Korea to South Korea, so we know that's going to happen. And he also saw Israel shooting two nuclear-tipped tactical missiles into the base of the Fort Dow facility mountain in Iran. So we know those things are going to happen. So we're right on the precipice of the North Korean event breaking loose right now. Kenneth?
Yeah, we really are, John. I mean, if you look at some of this rhetoric going on right now and all the things that are happening, I'm even seeing it in the mainstream, how they start to let the masses of the population know. Just listen to the rhetoric on the mainstream media right now. It is ramping up. And you start to hear the things coming out of the White House now from Vice President, the President, the Press Secretary, Secretary of Defense. There are so many different people in so many different areas where, you know, you just wake up and you say, wow, they're talking about it. So, yeah, it's ramping up, John.
Yeah, praise Jesus. It is. So we're in a holding pattern. We've been in a holding pattern for some time now. And what's really kind of interesting is that it's getting, what's really interesting is that we have this enormous list of things that we've been tracking, and it's like they're all sitting. It's hard to explain, but it's almost like, from a metaphor standpoint, that you've got this, that concept of a straw that breaks the camel's back, and now it's all just kind of stacking up, and it's getting more and more and more and more. We know these things are going to happen beyond a shadow of a doubt. We know it, but we don't know when. And right now, it appears, barring a change, barring a cataclysmic geological event, because remember, the prophet Dr. David O'Rourke just recently had a vision where he saw the sky rolling up. Okay, that indicates a manifestation possibly of the sixth seal. And I know people are like, well, you can't have the sixth seal before the third seal. And I'm going to try to explain this one more time. The first verse of Revelation says, and these things shall shortly come to pass. The word is tetakii in Greek. It means rapid fire succession. Now imagine seals, seal scrolls. So you have, imagine seven scrolls all in a row. Okay, you can break the seal on all six of the scrolls, but everything can happen all at once. You understand? So it can be a principle of sudden destruction, financial collapse, all hell breaking loose, sixth seal, comets falling from the sky, global earthquake, and thermonuclear war, all within the realm of a very short moment, or a few moments of time. It could all unravel really in 24 hours or even less. It takes 12 minutes for the nuclear missiles to move from the submarines to their targets. 12 minutes to obliterate the United States of America, the Russian subs. And we know that's coming. So praise God. We are on call. Hallelujah. Kenneth?
Yeah, we are, John. And then I was telling you before the show that I was watching Skyfall tonight. Terry got it for me on DVD. And one of the trailers before was that new the remake of the Red Dawn movie. I mean, we just look at all the doom and gloom movies that are out now with regard to, and there's always like a genre in the movies, but right now these things are all pointing towards some sort of collapse or cataclysm in the United States. Isn't that kind of ironic? And then with what I said right before, the ramp up in terms of what the mainstream media is starting to let people know, the U.S. is taking the threat in Korea, North Korea, seriously, And then I heard a news clip just on Saturday. They were saying that, South Korea and the U.S. will overwhelm them, but the North Koreans will give a good fight. I'm hearing this stuff now. They are actually talking about it.
We're going to dissect this, brother. We're going to dissect this because it looks like it's a complete setup. Wouldn't you agree?
John, it's weird. I mean,
it's staged.
Yes, yes. Amen, brother.
It's staged, folks, and we're going to cover that in just a couple of seconds here. It looks like it's a total setup, and we're going to cover those possibilities in the next couple of minutes. Praise God. Okay, so there is one more thing I wanted to bring to your attention. Inside the show notes, I'm going to skip over a lot of this so we can save some time, but inside the show notes, starting on page 36, if you have them, okay, there's an upswing of reports of Planet X. Okay, there was a report – I believe it was on CBS News. Maybe Kathy, if she prays real hard, can find the audio clip. I don't know. She's very good at finding things. But there was a person, I think it was CBS News, one of the head guys, talking on the news report. And he said that he hinted around in his dialogue about there would be something visible in the sky that would be about the size of the moon, and it would be caused by some, I think he implied there would be a supernova or something occurring somewhere out in the universe, and it would look like a second sun or a moon in our sky. And if any of the listeners of the radio show know what audio clip or YouTube video I'm talking about. It's mainstream media, and the guy said, I know I have it probably in my collection, but if you could send it to me, praise Jesus for you. He basically came out and said that come this September or this fall sometime, there would be a second, like, moon-like object about the size of the moon in our sky visible, okay? And they said it had to do with some kind of a nova or something, some other anomaly out in the universe. So they're basically greasing the rails for what's happening right now. Right now, as the Marshall Masters team and many of the other researchers out there have predicted, this second sun anomaly is on a substantial increase, and we're getting photographs and pictures and websites and articles and coast-to-coast discussions, and it's just crescendoing at a level that I haven't seen in quite some time. This is an article that was published on Before It's News, and basically it's entitled Planet X, Nibiru, Earth Magnetic Poles Shifting Rapidly. Okay, and I'm going to read a little snippet here, and it has an outstanding photograph of, you know, the second sun. Quote, once the approaching brown dwarf becomes visible in the sky, the general public is going to panic. Hence, they're greasing the rails, by the way, folks. They're prepared. They're already saying things on the mainstream news so that they can dumb down the population of the world and make them think it's some supernova in 50 million light years away, which is a lie. Okay, and it says, in this climate of panic, if the government allows law and order to break down, spilling anarchy into the streets, unruly crowds will severely damage the vital economic infrastructure by which the U.S. and most other Western Asian economies are so dependent. If this uncontrolled rioting and mayhem spills out of local neighborhoods and into the business districts of society, burning, looting, and ultimately destroying the businesses that drive this and other global economies, we're going to have a very difficult time recovering from the upcoming disaster. So let's not forget what happened in New Orleans, and the person goes on and on. Folks, that is the tip of the iceberg. When sudden destruction occurs on this Earth, it will start with global thermonuclear war. It will probably unravel into the most unbelievable cataclysmic global event, complete with what's referred to in Revelation 6, verse 12, I think it is, where it says, and the islands and the mountains moved out of place. That's a pole shift. El Zapata was shown not just an earthquake in the northeastern part of the United States and the devastation, but a tsunami. See, these are the kinds of things that are absolutely going to happen when all hell breaks loose here on Earth. It's going to be unbelievable. Now, the reason I'm bringing this forward is because there is an uptick. There's a crescendo of speakers out there who are getting out there. They're talking all over the place. They're, on Coast to Coast AM. They're on other radio shows. These folk, Christopher Rudy has this thing that he just published on a Yahoo site. It says President Obama to announce Planet X. This individual goes on and he says, a leading expert on Planet X inbound will be on Coast to Coast AM radio tonight at 11 p.m. So they're advertising this Gordon Gioninotto. Okay, and this guy is part of the – okay, how do I put this? There's multiple factions of the Galactic Federation of Lies – I mean light. And, well, it's one and the same. Okay, but the problem is they don't think they're part of the same group. They don't realize that it's an extraterrestrial alien demon fallen angel conspiracy. They don't understand that. They think they're on the good side. So each one of these guys, people or collective groups they think they're on the good side. So you've got the people who side with the ETs out there, and you got the people who side with the ETs down here. But they're all in it together. They're all Lucifer's minions. They're all here for the destruction and the slaughter, the wholesale slaughter of the human race and the enslavement of the population of the world. So Alex Jones has it correct. Praise Jesus. Alex Jones is right. It is about the enslavement of mankind. The problem is Alex hasn't connected it to the Bible. He doesn't realize really that it's about the worship of the beast, the worship of Lucifer, who has taken on the form of a human by dwelling inside the holy place. Anyway, praise Jesus. The reason I'm bringing this out is that in a couple of weeks we're gonna play some audio clips from this Gordon Giannotto, who's part of the ET group down here on Earth. Okay, he's associated with the pole shift and the Ning, Earth changes and the pole shift. You can search on that on Google, and it'll take you to their website. And they are followers of the Nancy Leader Zeta group. Okay, so they think these filthy, seething, demonic gray aliens are their friends. And it's rather unfortunate. And what's really unfortunate, folks, is that the intel that's coming from these people is by far the most accurate and unimpeachable intel I've ever seen. Their knowledge, their information is astonishingly accurate. And it follows the paradigm of 99.9% truth, 0.01% lies. And that's the worst case scenario, folks, because people jump on that bandwagon fast because they know, or they see that they're being told the truth. So they believe everything else is the truth. And then when the lies are told, they don't know it's a lie. Praise Jesus. Kenneth?
Yeah, amen, John. The real danger with those Zeta Talk people is that they're the same ones putting out the Zeitgeist type thing. And we're gonna, like you said, we're going to get into it more in another show. But so they're going to buy these things, the 99% truth, and then the compromised information they're going to present to the masses about our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ is what really, really is dangerous. Hey, Johnny, that big comet you're talking about is called Comet Ison. It's all over the astronomy web pages. They say on one of the web pages, this thing, this fault could be as bright as the full moon. And there's even some astronomers saying you're going to be able to see it during the daytime. And CNN did a piece with it. I sent it to your chat page there. You can mention it if you want. But, John, this thing's coming up. They're getting us ready. And then there was a Fox News commentator mentioned recently that they found some, you know, 10th body out there in deep solar system, you know, that's bringing all these comets in. It's not in the deep solar system. It's in the inner solar system right now. And so they can't keep this stuff quiet anymore, John.
Well, you know, that's the thing. I don't know that any of us really know exactly what's going on, you know, and let me just toss this out there as a possibility. Okay, so if you take and draw on a piece of paper – and imagine this is like a transparency for those of us who are like, you know, really old and we remember the Conestoga wagon days. And when we see, you know, one-way street arrows on the signs, we think about Indians, you know, like me. You know, when you've been around a while, you kind of remember transparencies and overhead projectors. Now imagine you have a transparency on your right and you draw a solar system. And it's got a little sun in the middle, and we'll just say, for sake of argument, five planets that rotate or, you know, go around it. Now, on your left, you have another transparency, and it's our solar system. And you put a sun in the middle, and then you put all of our planets around it. Now, take those two transparencies and slide them over top of one another. See, so people go, oh, you know, what is that that we're seeing on Neumeier Station? It looks like a planet that's really close to our planet. What is that? So, again, on page 39 of our show notes, we have a link there to it's amazing. Nibiru Wormwood Planet X Neumeier Station 3/29/2013. The photograph here is just absolutely jaw-dropping, and I've seen many of them. So what are you seeing when? At what point are you seeing what? Right? You know, again, if it's a solar system like Professor Harrington from, you know, the head guy of the United States Naval Observatory from the 90s who studied this in great detail, okay, he pointed out it has, this is a solar system, a failed solar system, and it's got planets, and it's got a failed star, a brown dwarf in the middle. Okay, so if you put those over the top of one another, what are we seeing at Neumayer? Is that Nibiru? Well, maybe not. Maybe it's one of the planets that are rotating around the brown dwarf. Is the brown dwarf Nibiru? Well, probably. I don't know. You know, it's hard to be sure. So praise God. All we know is there are signs in the sun and the moon and the stars on a level that it's unbelievable. Praise Jesus. This is exciting.
Something biblical is going on.
It's not normal.
It's just wrong.
It's not normal.
What? This is disturbing.
Kenneth. What's up with that laughing?
Hey, Johnny, it's not normal. It is disturbing. You know, there is something wrong. Come on, guys. I mean, come on, from that hurricane that hit the East Coast and these blizzards and all the weird things in the sky. And now I'm reading this thing on the website right now, on this astronomy website. This comet's going to be huge. And I'm thinking, this isn't normal.
I think it's a setup. I think that comet, I mean, maybe there's the comet, it's out there, maybe it's real, but I do not believe with all my heart that any comet, okay, is going to create an object in our sky the size of the moon during the day beside the sun. That is Nibiru, in my opinion. That is Nemesis Tyche, the destroyer, Jeremiah 5, verses 4 and 5, I believe it is. No, Jeremiah 4, verses 5. Praise God. Amen. The sign of the Son of Man. Praise Jesus. Matthew 24, 30. And folks, AccuWeather.com, look what's going to be happening over the central part of the United States. Okay, and this guy, Gordon Giovannito Nonito guy, points out correctly that because of the gravitational troughs and the pull and the waxing and the waning of the influence of Planet X and its associated satellites against the Earth, it causes Earth wobble, it causes tectonic plate shifts. Again, we're going to play snippets, audio snippets, and discuss this, I believe, on the 21st, praise God. Then, you know, this is it. I mean, this is what Isaiah 24, the earth wobbles like a drunkard. You know, our Heavenly Father uses lightning, uses natural events to levy judgment. So praise God. You know, the rain, the rain of Noah's flood, you know, somebody could go, oh, that's not God. That's just a really bad rainstorm. Yeah? Is that right? Well, that's what the unrighteous would think. Praise God. Everything is our Heavenly Father. Every particle, every atom, every quark, all 11 dimensions, it's just amazing. It's the power of Jesus that holds it all together. But you have to have that sanctified imagination. You have to have that sanctified understanding of the solar system or the universes to get that. And then you understand it's not just a rainstorm. As a matter of fact, praise Jesus, look at this. Here's a weather report that's coming for the United States. Listen to this. Multi-day severe weather on the plains commences. This is talking about an unbelievably severe hail, damaging winds, tornadoes all over the Oklahoma, all over the pretty much the central part of the United States, with potentially as much as an accumulation of 12 inches of snow in blizzard-like conditions with damaging winds, large hail. This is unbelievable, folks, and this is all supposed to be going down over the next couple of days. Look, it's April the 7th. This is absolutely unbelievable. Praise Jesus.
Are you serious? Something biblical is going on with the signs of the second coming of Christ.
Yeah, amen. Kenneth? You there, brother?
I muted my mic. Sorry, I thought it was... You know what, brother? Brother, you know what? He is so awesome. He is the Most High God, and he's our Father. But you know what you were talking about? He's got it all in control. And sure, he uses natural phenomena. Why? Because he created the natural phenomenon. And you just look at these stars out there. You know, there's that one that's bigger than the Earth, like by like it's like it reaches out to where we are in our orbit, and it's called Betelgeuse. And then there's one that like that's like I forget how many times bigger, but it's like it's humongous. I mean, it's called the Big Dog, you know. And I love this one scripture out of Psalms. It says, he tells the number of the stars. He calls them by their names. And back in Genesis 1:1, he spoke. He literally spoke them into existence, brother. And that's our Father.
Oh, yeah, amen. Read Psalms 29. It talks about the voice of the Lord is over the waters. The glory, the God of the glory thunders. The Lord is over many waters. The voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is full of majesty. It breaks the cedars. Okay, it divides the lightning. Okay, that's verse 7. Praise God. I mean, it's so awesome. It's so awesome. All right, listen to these. This is very important information. This marks what we're dealing with right now. Praise Jesus. China mobilizing troops. Jets near the North Korean border, U.S. official says. China has placed military forces on heightened alert in the northeastern part of the country as tensions mount in the Korean Peninsula following the recent threats by Pyongyang to attack the United States. Here's another one. WorldNet Daily, a guy by the name of Michael Malouf, comes out and says, U.S. on alert for nuclear blast overhead. He's pushing the threat of an electromagnetic pulse. So that would be where North Korea did somehow get their hands on a missile with, a warhead, an atomic warhead, a nuclear warhead, and were able to just lob it over Hawaii and have the thing detonate in the air over the western part of the United States, and it would cause a complete blackout of electronic equipment. Okay, pretty similar to what happened in the very beginning of the movie War of the Worlds. The new one, praise Jesus. Okay, I do not think that that's going to happen. The reason I don't think that's going to happen is because it just doesn't match. You know, surely the Lord God does nothing without first revealing it through his servants, the prophets, Amos 3:7. So when we're listening to the prophets, it appears that, well, North Korea is about to lob a bunch of missiles against the United States and South Korea at any moment. Okay, here's another one. A Times of Israel. Israeli planes strike Gaza for the first time since the Pillar of Defense. So now we've got Israel sending in, you know, jets into Gaza and dropping bombs, you know, so that, you know, that's ramping up. All right, praise God. Here's another headline. U.S. secretly deploys B-1 strategic bombers, E-6 doomsday planes near North Korea. Okay, and we got a report from somebody on our Facebook page. Praise Jesus for all of you on the Facebook page. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Because we got a global. We have pastors from all over the world that listen to this radio show. Glory to Jesus for you. Pastor Rock, brother, over in the Philippines, thank you for the emails and the text messages I get from you. God bless you, brother. We had people notifying us that these big bombers and military equipment are landing in the Philippines. So the whole Pacific Rim is getting filled up, Guam and Philippines, and we're putting remarkable amounts of machinery over there. They're not doing this for no reason. Praise Jesus. Okay, so then there's a huge headline that came out on Mail Online, and it was promulgated across the internet many different places, but it said, and I'm going to read the headline, it's a long one. We will not back down. West slams North Korea after madman dictator is pictured brandishing a gun and warns that diplomats' safety is at risk after April 10th. April 10th, that's this Wednesday. That's this Wednesday. Now, here is why this is so alarming. This is what perhaps some of us may not have thought of. Why are there Reuters photographs of Kim Jong-un, shooting pistols up close, marking targets, and looking through binoculars? If this guy's about to go to war, what's Reuters doing there? Who's releasing these photographs? This is a setup. This is a setup. If my sanctified hunch is correct on this one, praise Jesus, this is a globalist setup. they are doing this on purpose. They have probably cut a deal with Kim Jong-un to get him out of there safely if he starts this war. It's that dark out there, folks. It looks like this is a complete setup. All right, it looks like the, for lack of a better term, the shape-shifting reptilian star freak evil cabal, the extraterrestrial military industrial complex that's running this dark demon-infested rock are putting together a master plan to launch World War III at the hands of what they are selling the world as a psychopath. This is a repeat of the Saddam Hussein Iraq deal all over again to usher in World War III. It's just way too orchestrated. This whole thing is choreographed, folks. They are going to decimate North Korea. This is planned. The headlines are unbelievable. Listen to this. Moment of explosion is near. North Korea madman's new warning as U.S. deploys battalion expert in nuclear and chemical warfare after rogue states move its missiles to the coast. North Korea vows to reopen nuclear power plant capable of making atomic bomb after South says it could strike first. Prime Minister Cameron insists that we are in for a range of Korea's missiles as he tours the nuclear submarine. And get out of Korea now. All embassies are told to evacuate the staff. Pyongyang, after madman dictator warns he cannot guarantee the safety of foreigners. The list goes on and on and on. It's unbelievable. This is, they look, and then there's even a headline right here. This one, Kenneth, God bless you. Talk about this one, Kenneth. Go ahead and grab the microphone right here. Will globalists use North Korea to trigger catastrophe? This person brings up, 7 points that are very powerfully, they indicate that this is all orchestrated. It's a choreographed ushering in. And think about it. Folks, think about this. If these entities, these beings, these demonic beings successfully promulgate World War III by architecting this such that North Korea, quote, a madman, starts it, then what you have is plausible deniability. All the entities, the Chinese, the Russians, the United States, all these different governments that are salivating for the opportunity to launch global thermonuclear war can step away and go, we couldn't help it. We couldn't help it. We had to defend ourselves. Praise Jesus. Kenneth?
Yeah, amen, John. There are so many different things there. Like, you know, this isn't his daddy anymore, you know? This is new leadership. That's the first point here. And they basically cut off the armistice they were under for like the last, 60-some years, you know, and they've declared a state of war, you know, opened up their nuclear reactor again. You know, they've shut down the joint industrial region they had with South Korea. There's some serious moves in regard to what they're doing with silver purchases out of China. You know, these things are all pointing to a nation preparing for war, but John, I just smell something here. It's a setup. And then flip on Saturday Night Live last night, and they're making jokes about it. You know, they're making jokes about it. It just makes me want to weep. But this is not right, brother.
Oh, no, it's not. It's going to be absolutely horrible. Folks, again, I don't know how else to put it except in the name of Jesus, please get the sin out of your life. Repent every single morning of any sin that you even might have committed. Seek the Lord with all of your heart. Be on your knees before Him in the morning. Pray, Father, in the name of Jesus, please forgive me for any of my sins that I may have committed over the last 24 hours, over the last couple of days. Seek Him. Ask Him to purify your heart. Pray Psalms 51. Pray the rapture prayers for purification. They're published on tribulation-now.org. They're in the Black Banner section, and that has the same title, Rapture Prayers for Purification. Pray them. You know, seek God because you do not want to be here. You do not want to be here. Praise Jesus. All right, now we're going to break into the rapture scriptures. We've been touching upon the rapture stuff throughout the show, but now we're going to hit it hard and intensely. We're going to cover all the script, not every single scripture, but we're going to hit the big hitters of the rapture scriptures here on the eve of the True News radio broadcast that the Lord has blessed us with an opportunity to be part of. Praise God. And we're going to share these with you right now. Glory to Jesus. All right, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. All right, and all right, here we go. Thank you, Jesus. Praise Jesus. Praise Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father, for this opportunity. Thank you, Father, for this opportunity to share this wonderful, wonderful, wonderful set of scriptures with the listening audience to build hope, to give us hope, to understand that our time here is very limited and that you, Lord Jesus, are coming back for your bride. May we be found worthy to escape all these things and stand before the Son of Man. Luke 21:36. Praise Jesus. Praise Jesus. All right. So in the show notes on page, starting with page 79, we have a table that's a little rough drafty of scriptures. And it starts out with a section entitled Understanding Mysteries. And at this point, I'm going to turn the microphone over to Brother Kenneth because he's got some stuff that's real exciting to share regarding Jesus and not just the fact that, you know, that Jesus used parables to teach, but also the, you know, kind of the why did Jesus use parables to teach. And Kenneth, go ahead.
Well, you know, John, right after he gave the parable of the four soils, you know, he said this over in Mark chapter 4, verses 10 through 14. And he was alone with the disciples, and they asked him about the parable. And he said to them, "Unto you it's given to know the mystery of the kingdom of God. But unto them that are without, all these things are done in parables, that seeing they may see and not perceive, and hearing they may hear and not understand, lest at any time they should be converted and their sins be forgiven." And he said to them, "You know this parable? And you know about all the parables?" And then he goes in and he explains it. So the point here is, he's saying, you know, I'm gonna teach this to you, but there's people out there that are hard-hearted. They're not ready for it. They haven't repented of their sin. And then it goes on in verses 33 and 34, and I love this. It's so powerful. And it says, this is in the Gospel of Mark. He says, "And with many such parables he spake the word unto them, as they were able to hear it. But without a parable, he spake not unto them. And when they were alone, he expounded all things to his disciples." So that's so important to understand. There are these hard-hearted people out there that are just not willing to repent and make him their Lord. You mentioned that when you opened the show. He's not only our Savior. First and foremost, he has to be our Lord. So then he's going to keep these things revealed. And that's what I saw in there. And those scriptures just jumped off the page at me, brother.
Yeah, amen. It's the soft, humble, and contrite heart which the Lord loves. And that soft, humble, and contrite heart is the heart which he reveals his mysteries to. So when you take a hard-line stance on your beliefs, it's not the kind of heart that the Lord is looking to reveal his mysteries to. Okay, you have to have an open heart and an open mind. So understanding the mysteries, that's covered in Luke 8:17-18. "For nothing is secret that will not be revealed, nor anything hidden that will not be known and come to light. Therefore take heed how you hear. For whoever has knowledge, to him more will be given. And whoever does not have knowledge, even what he seems to have will be taken away from him. So those who are left behind will be in such utter shock, and their mind will be blown by the strong delusion. All right, it's going to be hell on earth. They're not going to know what hit them. It's going to be absolutely unbelievable. Praise God. Okay, another key verse for understanding the mysteries of the Bible is that God conceals things. He intentionally conceals. Now, that Kenneth just covered that in his description of the parables, very eloquently, I might add. Praise Jesus. Thank you, Kenneth. And Proverbs 25, verse 2 has a mystery that's revealed to us, and it says, "It is the glory of God to concealeth a matter, but the glory of kings is to search out a matter." So here you see that God conceals things on purpose, because not everyone is invited. You have to exhibit the humble and contrite heart before the Lord, and then he reveals those mysteries to you. You see, there are prerequisite behaviors that the Lord is looking for from your heart before you're going to be given that information, and that requires taking heed how you hear. There's a saying, it's a good saying, it goes like this: a man convinced against his will is of the same opinion still. Your will must not have an existing opinion. If you're determined to believe something, the Lord will let you believe it. And then last but not least is God will not hear. Okay, Psalm 66:18 says, "If I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear." Okay, now what that means, lines upon lines, precepts upon precepts, here a little, there a little, what that means is, you know, the inferred meaning there is that if you have potentially sin in your life, or you have behaviors in your heart that are not humble and contrite, that are not seeking the Lord in humility, then it's possible that not only that the Lord may not hear some of the things that you are asking him for, but he won't reveal things to you either. Okay, so it all kind of snaps together into this set of prerequisite heartfelt behaviors that are required for the Lord to be able to speak to your heart and be willing to speak to your heart about these wonderful things. Praise Jesus. Kenneth?
That's so true. What you just said is so true, John. And that that scripture out of Psalms about if you favor or harbor iniquity in your heart, he won't hear your prayers. It's so sad what I see so many of these people do, and they just lash out on people that are trying to encourage the bride to prepare for the return of the bridegroom. I can't get it. I cannot understand that. So, you know, if you don't agree with what we're saying, take that up with the Lord. Take it up with your private time with this. But I don't understand why anybody would come out and start bashing. I mean, there's no agenda here. It's to try to share what the Lord's revealed to us in the scriptures and what we're so passionate about. Repent. The day's at hand. He's coming back.
Oh, yeah. Amen. Praise Jesus. Praise Jesus. And, okay, so the next section of our table of rapture scriptures is in regard to bridal party requirements. What is required of you to be considered as part of the bride? Because, you know, the visions and the dreams of those, including Dr. David Auer and many, 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 probably thousands of other people, Chu Thomas, Elvie Zapata, the list goes on, is when they were shown the rapture taking place, only a small percentage made it in the churches. So let's take a look at that. First off, you are told by Jesus in Luke 21:36 to pray always that you will be found worthy to escape all these things, not just some of them, all these things spoken of during the Olivet Discourse, and stand before the Son of Man. Get it? All right? Praise Jesus. Okay? All right? So that's critical. Why would Jesus say that you could escape all these things, if you couldn't? Well, he wouldn't say it. So there's a guarantee that there is a rescue mission. For who? The bride. What's required? Ephesians 5:27. That he, Jesus, might present her, that's the bride, to himself a glorious church. It's the Church of Philadelphia, Revelation 3:10. Not having a spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and without blemish. Okay? Amen? So that's why we plead with you on every radio show to seek holiness. 1 John 3:7. He who practices righteousness by repenting constantly and adjusting their behavior, he who practices righteousness is righteous, just as he, Jesus, is righteous. And he who habitually and willfully sins is of the devil. Praise God. That's 1 John 3:8 from the Kenneth Voice. Habitually and willfully sins is of the devil. Now, so you understand you must be holy and without blemish and seeking the Lord with all your heart. The next thing you need to understand is that the Bible refers to things routinely in metaphor and symbolism, okay? And one of those things is oil, which is a metaphor for the Holy Spirit, and lamps, which is, you know, a metaphor for Christians, you know, the lampstands, okay? But look, when you read Matthew 25, you should know instantly that that is a metaphorical parable teaching about bridal party candidates. It's not talking about anybody else. It's just talking about bridal party candidates. How do you know? Because it says it talks about wise and foolish virgins. It talks about the bridegroom coming to get the wise virgins. It says that the wise virgins not only had oil in their lamps, but it was overflowing, that the vessels were even full, their spare vessels, which they carried extra oil in their lamps, that they were watching for Jesus, that they were excited about Jesus. That's what made them wise. And the foolish virgins were the ones who said things like, oh, you know, I'll see you on the way up if there's a rapture. I'll see you on the way up if there's a rapture. No, you won't. That's what the rapture, that's what Matthew 25 is teaching here. Not everybody's going. You have to be looking for Jesus with all your heart. You have to be like a giddy bride, excited. And if you're not, if you're doubtful, if you're on the fence, you're probably not coming. I pray that you are. Praise Jesus. Kenneth?
I love that. I love that parable of those 10 virgins, John. I love the way you just put it there. I mean, and stop and think about this for a minute. What if we're wrong? What if we're wrong? Well, then what? You're a little more holy? You're a little more righteous? You're a little bit more in tune with the Lord? Wow, that's really a bad thing. But then what if we're right and you don't embrace it? Oh, boy. Oh boy, I don't even want to go there. And then just amplifying that one scripture you said, about he who practices righteousness is righteous. And then John amplifies that and just drives that point home a little earlier in 1 John chapter 2, verse 29, where he says, if you know that he, that's Jesus, is righteous, you know that everyone that does righteousness is born of him. So, I mean, come on, what other way would you want to live? I'm going to choose to live like those five wise virgins, wicks trimmed, and my vessel, that's my body, like Paul said, full of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Praise God. And so for those who are really following along close, you want to write down the words bridegroom, bride, lamp, oil, marriage. Okay, you want to write those words down, okay, because you're going to see those metaphors popping up over and over again all throughout the New Testament and Revelation. And when you do, guess who it's talking about? Yeah, praise God. Hallelujah. That's what it's talking about. It's talking about the bride. It's talking about the bridegroom. That's a special group. It's not everybody. That's why this is so exciting. Okay, so there's another section of the table in the show notes called General Rapture Proof Through Inference. And again, the meaning of the scripture that is inferred is often more powerful and more important than the literal meaning. Amen? Okay, remember Proverbs 25:2. It is the glory of God to conceal it. a matter. Amen? Praise God. All right, 1 Thessalonians 5:9. For God did not appoint us to wrath. Well, is wrath only Revelation 6:17 at the manifestation of the sixth seal? Well, maybe. I argue that it's the sudden destruction. Do they all happen at the same time? I think so. But for sure, the sudden destruction is definitely the wrath of God. Okay, so if you look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, praise Jesus. All right, and I'm going to pull this up here real quick because this is absolutely critical. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, it says, "For you know perfectly that the day of the Lord so comes as a thief in the night." And we're going to cover that in a second. This isn't going to take that long, folks. And you can get a copy of the show notes at show-notes.info or www.tribulation-now.net. Okay, we upload those. God bless you, Brother Lee, for your hard work getting those up there so people can read them and have copies. Okay, for verse 3, "For when they say peace and safety, then sudden destruction comes upon them." Pay attention to the pronoun. It comes upon them. See, Paul didn't say it comes upon us. He says it comes upon them. And they shall not escape. Why? Because we will. Luke 21:36, "Pray always to be found worthy to escape all these things and stand before the Son of Man." Proof. It's proof. And then verse 4 nails it. "But you, brethren," see, now Paul is turning to his brethren. He just said, and they, you can see Paul standing up on a rock talking to the church of Thessalonica. And he's pointing over, he's like, "And sudden destruction will come upon them." And he takes his right arm and he points it over into the field and he goes, "It's going to come upon them and they shall not escape." And then he says, then he turns his face over to the people in the church and he says, "But you, brethren, are not in the darkness so that this day should overtake you as a thief. You are sons of the light and sons of the day. We are not of the night or the darkness. Therefore, let us not sleep as others do. Let us watch and be sober." Praise Jesus. Kenneth?
I love that scripture, Johnny. I love that scripture. Watch and be sober. There's no better way to live. I mean, come on. You want to be asleep like those five foolish virgins? Or worse yet, drunk in the night, like the people out there choosing to live with the ways of the world rather than the ways of Christ. You know, there's a scripture, and I don't have the address on the top of my head, but it says to love the world is to be at enmity with God. You know, brother, I'm going to live in Christ.
Oh, yeah. Amen. Praise God. So now we're going to connect some more dots, some more symbolism. We're going to, with the glory of kings is to search out a matter. And that's what we're doing together right now tonight. Praise Jesus. And we are going to become servant kings. Praise Jesus. Okay. A royal priesthood over the new age. This is what we're striving for here. Praise God. Matthew 25. Listen. "Then the kingdom of heaven shall be likened to 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom." Okay, so bride, bridegroom, bride, got it? This is about the rapture of the bride. "Now 5 of them were wise, but there were foolish ones." Okay, those who were foolish took their lamps with no oil, that's Holy Spirit, but the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. They had extra Holy Spirit. They were bubbling over with praise and worship and excited about Jesus coming. But while the bridegroom was delayed, they all slumbered and slept. Okay, now listen, bridegroom, okay, lamps, okay, you connecting all of these metaphors, are you seeing how this all works? All right, now here, listen to this. Luke 12:35-40. "Let your waist be girded and your lamps burning." So what is Jesus talking about here? Well, Luke 12:35-40 is talking about the rapture. Hallelujah. How do we know? Because it's so awesome. Listen to this. "Let your waist be girded and your lamps burning." That's referring back to Matthew 25. "And you yourself be like men who wait for their master when he will return from the wedding. That's the wedding supper. That's the wedding supper, the marriage supper of the Lamb. Now, why is Jesus talking about returning? Well, let's look. He goes, that when he comes and knocks, that they may open to him immediately. Blessed are those servants for whom the master, when he comes, will find watching. Assuredly, I say to you that he will gird himself and have them sit down to eat at the marriage supper, and will come and serve them. And if he should come in the second watch or the third watch and find them so, blessed are those servants. Folks, do you get this? Do you understand this parable? This parable not only refers to keeping your lamps burning full of Holy Spirit oil as a wise virgin, but it also implies that Jesus may come back on a second watch or a third watch, that there may be more than one rapture rescue mission events that occur. And when you read Revelation and you see the tribulation saints and you see the two witnesses and you read about how they're taken up to heaven, those are evacuation missions. This is exciting. Could the third watch be when the elect are collected from the far reaches of the heaven, from the four winds in Matthew 24:30? I don't know. Maybe. But look at the metaphor. It just absolutely bubbles over with rapture, bridal party, lamps burning, back from the marriage supper, watching third watch, second watch. This is screaming rapture of the bride. Praise God. Kenneth?
You know, John, and I'm saying this in a very kind way because that's how Pastor Rick Wiles asked me the question when we were recording the show. But do you remember when he said, show me the scripture that talks about a secret return? And I wish I would have shown that to him, brother. That's it right there. That's it. Praise Jesus. And God bless him. He had such a kind heart. This was not a debate. This was just a conversation among people that saw the scriptures differently. So, yeah, I'm praying that the Lord opens Rick's eyes to this, but it's right there. It's right there, John. You answered his question.
Oh, praise Jesus, praise Jesus. I just believe with all my heart that Brother Rick Wiles is going to come around. He's going to grab that microphone, and he's going to say, folks, listen to this. And we're going to be saying hallelujah, and I'll be crying alligator tears of joy and praise to our King. Because what a blessing this is. Praise God. Nobody should have to suffer like people do. The problem is that so many people don't understand how horrible the Great Tribulation is going to be. They don't really get it. They don't understand that there's going to be alien, demon, fallen angels slaughtering children. It's going to make Nazi Germany seem like a picnic. Now, turn with me, if you have your Bible, turn to Revelation 2:22, and then also look up Revelation 3:10. What we're going to do is we're going to compare two of the seven churches and what Jesus says about them. Okay? This is critical because this is an absolute slam dunk. Okay? If you don't see this, you need to seek the Lord in prayer. This is undeniably 1,000% nails it. Okay, praise Jesus. All right, now watch. If you read Revelation 2 and Revelation 3, what you're seeing there is Jesus is giving a report card. It's a metaphorical report card to the seven churches. Okay, these churches are metaphorical, and they are basically synonymous with Christian groups across the world today. And in each one of the report cards, and for example, in the Church of Laodicea, which is most awful, Jesus said, I would want for you to either be cold or hot, but because you're lukewarm, I will vomit you out of my mouth. What that means is you should have known better. You should have known better. See, if you were cold, you didn't know any better. If you were hot, you're probably the Church of Philadelphia, and you're on your way out of here. Praise God. But if you're lukewarm, Jesus vomits you out of his mouth. That is not going to heaven, folks. But the Church of Thyatira in Revelation 2:22 and the Church of Philadelphia, Revelation 3:10, when they are placed side by side, as they are in the show notes here, on page 83, you can see one church is cast into the Great Tribulation because of its behavior, and the other church is the opposite. It is rescued off the earth. It's plain as day. Revelation 2, 22 and 23. This is the disposition, the judgment on the church of Thyatira. Indeed, I will cast her into great tribulation unless they repent of their deeds. Did you hear that? All right, I'll read the whole thing. I will not take out any words this time, but I was doing that for emphasis purpose. Indeed, I will cast her into a sickbed and those who commit adultery with her into great tribulation. The word is great tribulation. That is the horrible time that's referred to in Daniel 12 that we read earlier. Unless they repent of their deeds. So there you see Jesus saying that he is going to throw those in the church of Thyatira, this metaphorical church, because of their behavior and because they didn't repent, into the great tribulation. Wow. Now let's compare that to Revelation 3, verse 10. This is the opposite. Because you have kept my command to persevere, I also will keep you from the hour of trial, which shall come upon the whole earth to test those who dwell upon the earth. To test those who, what? Who dwell upon the earth. So he's going to keep you away from the hour of trial that's going to come upon the whole earth to test those who dwell upon the earth. What's the inferred meaning? Clearly, the Church of Philadelphia is not on the earth. Praise Jesus. If you look at those two verses side by side and you do not see that the rapture will occur, the hour of trial, people trip over that. How do you trip over the hour of trial? That is simply a metaphor for the Great Tribulation. If you go to Revelation 17, all right, you go to Revelation 17, and I'm looking for it right now. Praise Jesus. Okay, listen to this. So here's your proof that the hour of trial is the duration of the Great Tribulation, as if I should have to explain it. But praise God. For those who need that confirmation, go to Revelation 17, verse 12. The ten horns which you saw are ten kings who have received no kingdom as yet, but they receive authority for 1 hour as kings with the beast. Folks, you know, these ten kings, these ten horns, these alien demon manifesting in temple body freakazoids that are going to come to this earth, and we've covered this on other shows, these fallen angel entity beings are not going to only receive authority for 1 hour. Please, this is not referring to 60 minutes. This is referring to the duration of the Great Tribulation. Praise God. So there you have it. Revelation 2, 22, they cast the Church of Thyatira into the Great Tribulation. And Revelation 3, 10, the Church of Philadelphia is delivered from the hour of trial, the Great Tribulation, that comes to test those who are dwelling on the earth because Philadelphia is gone. Praise Jesus. Kenneth?
Yeah, John, when you first brought those two scriptures up to me, you know, Revelation 2, 22 and 3, 10, I was blown away. I looked at that, and I thought, I just prayed, Lord, how many times have I read the book of Revelation because of the special blessing you promised to all of us who hear these words and read these words? So I've read that book quite a few times, brother, and I have never seen that. And it jumps off the page now. I can't miss it. I can't miss it now. And how about that one over in Revelation 18:23? Wow. You know, that the fall of Babylon. And what's removed, John? What's removed?
Yeah, the bride and the bridegroom will be heard in you no more. What is that doing there? That's the destruction of Babylon the Great. It's burned in 1 hour. It's thermonuclear destruction of the United States by Russian missiles. Why does it say the bride and the bridegroom will be heard in you no more? Because the rapture happens. Praise Jesus. Folks, again, the outbound departure, you can go to tribulation-now.org and click on preparing for the you can go to the table of contents, all right, which is a link at the very end of the black banner section, and you can hit Control F and type preparing for the outbound departure, and you can read that article. Okay, again, the Wycliffe Bible of 1384, the Tyndale Bible of 1526, the Coverdale Bible of 1535, the Cranmer Bible of 1539, the Breeches Bible of 1576, the Beza Bible of 1583, the Geneva Bible of 1608, and also the World English Bible, which I don't know the date of that one. All of those use the word departure. And according to Kenneth Woist, arguably the greatest Greek scholar that lived during the 20th century, he says, and I agree with him, that 2 Thessalonians 2, verses 1 through 5, that it doesn't refer to the falling away, that instead it refers to the departure, or the aforementioned departure of the church to heaven. So the aforementioned departure of the church to heaven must come first, and then the man of lawlessness is disclosed. Praise Jesus. And also, isn't it fascinating that we've already proven beyond, in my belief, with all of my heart, I believe that we have proven beyond a shadow of a doubt that the rapture is absolutely undeniable. It is a fact. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. All right. And we haven't even touched on the scriptures that the pre-trib people point to. As a matter of fact, in the table, I refer to these scriptures as, and they're grouped in a section called uncertain affinity. Okay, now why did I call them that? Okay, because one could easily, well, pretty much make some arguments here that maybe 1 Corinthians 15:52 may be referring to after the tribulation of those days. Okay, so you have the before part, before the tribulation, that's the rapture of the bride, and then you have the second coming of Jesus after the great tribulation. Amen. Okay, and we're gonna cover those scriptures real quick here. We're just about to wrap up the show, but this is very, very important. So if you read 1 Corinthians 15:51 through 53, it says, "Behold, I tell you a mystery: we shall not all sleep, but we shall be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed." Now, some people might like to argue that that might be after the Great Tribulation. So if you go to Matthew 24:29, that's where it talks about after. Okay, it says immediately, this is verse 29, immediately after the tribulation of those days, the sun will be darkened, the moon will not give its lights, the stars will fall from the heaven, and the powers of the heaven will be shaken, and the sign of the Son of Man, planet X, will appear in heaven, and all the tribes of the earth will mourn. Does that sound like a surprise to anybody? Is anybody snuck up on like a thief in the night there? I don't think so. That's after the tribulation. How can anybody be snuck up on like a thief in the night when 2.25 billion people are dead by the end of the sixth trumpet judgment? I don't think so. How can anybody be snuck up on like a thief in the night when, you know, a third of the grass and the trees burn in the first trumpet? Mm-mm. Nope, nobody gets snuck up on. Praise Jesus. So again, you can look at 1 Thessalonians 4, verses 15, or actually verse 18. Okay, and there you see where it says, "For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first, and those who are alive and remain shall be caught up." There's that term in Latin, which is rapturo. That's where the word is extrapolated from. "Together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we will always be with the Lord." Now listen, verse 18 is the key. "Therefore comfort one another with these words." That, I think that verse 18 is by far, hands down, the most important verse right there. Praise Jesus. "Therefore comfort one another with these words." Why would you be comforted? Oh, there's going to be alien invasions. They're going to rip the arms and legs off the children in front of you. They're going to ravage your wives. Read Isaiah 13. You're going to suffer thermonuclear war. Your eyes and your tongues are going to melt out of their sockets. There's going to be, you know, people walking around like zombies. Oh, it's going to be hell on earth. There'll be a pole shift, tsunamis. It'll be the most horrible time that the earth has ever seen since the beginning of the universe. But therefore, comfort each other with these words. Kenneth?
John, that term, you know, caught up, it's used, I think, like four times in that translation to English, but in every other instant, it's to snatch out of danger. It's to take away quickly. And it's always used in some instance where there's some implied threat or some implied danger. So, you know, the word rapture isn't in the Bible, but it's the Latin version of it. It's that word caught up, and every instant when it's used, it's referring to pulling something or someone out of danger's way into safety. It's amazing, John. Or just it's the Greek Strong's 0726. Look it up, and I'll tell you what. It's amazing when you start to see how it's applied in the scriptures. It's always to take out of danger quickly.
That's awesome. Praise God. Amen. That's awesome. All right. So in closing, it's interesting that we're using this as our closing argument. And you know, the defense rests, right? Amen. But this happens to be was our opening argument, if you will, when we were blessed by being allowed to come on Rick Wiles' True News show to discuss this. And Brother Rick asked me if I would start the roundtable discussion, and this was the point that I made. And we've already touched upon this a little bit, but we're going to slam dunk this home. Okay, so the question is, does Jesus come a second time only once? Is there only a second coming of Jesus? Because most people who think there is no rapture, okay, and yes, there are, you know, some holes in pre-trib theory. That's why I believe it's pre-wrath. That's fine. I don't agree with Tim LaHaye at all. I don't agree with most of these folks out there. I don't agree when it comes, you know, Chuck Misler, Hal Lindsey, Jack Van Impe, Hagee, all these guys. They all think that the whole church, everybody who comes to church on Sunday is going to go up in the rapture. That's not true. That's not right. God bless them for hoping like that, but it's not right. Praise Jesus. All right, now. So here's the point, before versus after, okay? So this in the show notes is on page 91, and it's broken into a table. On the left column is the before, that's the rapture, and then after is when Jesus comes, you could argue as the second coming. Now, people will point to the trumpets. They'll say, well, there's a last trumpet, and there's a shout, the voice of an archangel, and Jesus comes, and he gathers his bride. Now, here's the thing that's really important to note regarding the sound of the trumpet and Jesus shouting like with the voice of an archangel to collect his bride. Okay, and that those are, we covered those in, you know, 1 Corinthians 15:52, 1 Thessalonians 4, it also makes those references. Praise God. Now, check it out. According to the visions and the dreams of those who have been shown the rapture, including Dr. David O'Rourke and some other people, the only ones who actually hear the trumpet, the shout for the bride, is the bride itself, that the other people don't hear it. They see the animals, your pets and things going up and the bridal party members leaving. They see it happening, but they don't hear the trumpet. Only ones who hear the trumpet and the shout of Jesus is the bride themselves. Huh? Amen. Praise God. All right, so Jesus comes like a thief, like a snare, that's on the left side, and he comes in great glory at the very end, and that's on the right side. Now remember, no one will be surprised at the end of the Great Tribulation. No one will be caught like a thief in the night at the end of the Great Tribulation. That is simply impossible. A little common sense, trib and trumpet, prophetical exegesis is in order here. Praise Jesus. You cannot be surprised if you are unburying dead, if the world has been turned, flipped upside down, global thermonuclear war, billions of people dead. It can't happen. So, now that we understand that, and also look at Mark 13:20. Unless the Lord had shortened those days, no flesh would have been saved. Does that sound like a pretty bad time on earth to you? But for the elect's sake, whom he chose, he, our Heavenly Father, shortened those days. That's how bad it was. No surprise. You can't sneak up on somebody in those circumstances. So again, here we go. Here's the verses that refer to Jesus coming like a thief or like a snare. Again, chapter 12 of Luke. Let your waist be girded and your lamps burning. That's referring to the bride, the wise virgins in Matthew 25. And yourselves be like men who wait for their master when he returns from the wedding, that when he comes and knocks, that they may be open to that they may open to him immediately. Okay. So there, it refers to a little further down in verse 39. But know this, that if the master of the house had known what hour the thief would come, he would have watched. Huh? There's a thief reference. Surprise. 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 2. For you yourselves know perfectly well that the day of the Lord, that's the start of the Great Tribulation and the duration of the Great Tribulation, the day of the Lord actually is the sudden destruction day. Okay, that's the day of the Lord, but it also metaphorically refers to the entire 1260 days of the Great Tribulation. Okay, so the day of the Lord also refers to the Great Tribulation. You have to understand the duplicitous meaning of the day of the Lord. It's not a single day. It's not 24 hours. So comes as a thief in the night. That's verse 2. 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 2. So the day of the Lord so comes as a thief in the night. There it is. When they say peace and safety, sudden destruction comes upon them, and they shall not escape. Praise God. All right? That's another thief in the night. 2 Peter 3:10. But the day of the Lord, it's great tribulation, will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens will pass away with a great noise, and the elements will melt with fervent heat, but the earth and the works that are in it will be burned up. Sounds like global thermonuclear war to me. Praise Jesus. And here's another one. Luke 21, 34 to 36. But take heed to yourself, lest your hearts be weighed down with carousing, drunkenness, and cares of this life, that that day shall come upon you unexpectedly. For it will come as a snare on all those who dwell on the face of the whole earth. There it is again. That implies that the bride will not be here. If it comes as a snare on those who dwell on the earth, and in Revelation 3:10 it says, I will keep you from the hour of trial which comes upon those, comes upon the whole earth to test those who what? Dwell upon the earth. So Luke 21:34 to 36 comes as a snare to all those who dwell on the earth. And Revelation 3:10, I will save you from the hour of a trial to test those who dwell on the earth. Those two verses go hand in hand. Amen? Praise Jesus. Watch ye therefore and pray always that ye may be counted worthy to escape all these things which come to pass and stand before the Son of Man. Not some of the things, not a couple of the things, all of the things. And Jesus is not a fibber. Praise Jesus. Thank you, Father. This is exciting. Now I'm going to close this with the opposite side of that argument. These are the rapture verses. These are the thief in the night verses. These are the things that catch the entire population of the earth off guard. As in the days of Noah, they will be giving and taking in marriage. They will not be paying attention. They will not be watching. And they will be caught off guard. Now, at the end, Jesus comes in great glory. Jude 14 through 15. Now Enoch, the seventh from Adam, prophesied about these men, saying, Behold, the Lord comes with 10,000s of his saints to execute judgment on all. Matthew 24:29. Immediately after the tribulation of those days, the sun will be darkened, the moon will not give its light, the stars will fall from the heaven, and the power of the heavens will be shaken. Then the sign of the Son of Man, Planet X, will appear in the heaven, and then all the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven in power and great glory. That doesn't sound like a surprise to me. Revelation 19, verse 14, And the armies in the heaven, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, followed him, Jesus, on white horses. Praise Jesus in great glory. Hallelujah. Kenneth?
John, that's so clear. So very clear, it has to be two events. One is a surprise, only known to those waiting, and the other is just like in your face. You can't miss that. So I just pray. What my prayer is to anyone out there who's on the fence or who just is a naysayer to this, Just talk to the Lord. Ask him to reveal this stuff to you. You know that scripture out of Luke, right after he taught us how to pray, you know, the Our Father that you talked about before? It says, you know, what father would give their son a scorpion if he asked for an egg? How much more so will the Father, the Heavenly Father, our Heavenly Father, give us the Holy Spirit if we ask for it? And Jesus said, I give you the Spirit of truth to lead you unto all things. So just ask the Father to give you the Holy Spirit. Ask him to fill you with the Holy Spirit and reveal these things to you, and he will. He'll do that.
Amen. Praise Jesus. Praise Jesus. Well, folks, again, we thank you for joining us tonight. We thank you for hanging in there for another long show. The amount of information that's out there is just staggering, and keeping up with it is just, you know, it takes the power of Jesus and every one of us to hang in there, to overcome the sin that's in our lives, to seek ye first the kingdom and his righteousness so that all these things will be given unto us. Father, in the name of Jesus, I lift up every listener of this radio show, and I ask you, Father, please, for an anointing of your Holy Spirit to fill every listener. Father, I pray that in the name of Jesus, that for those who are ready, that their hearts are humble and contrite, that you will not only reveal the mysteries of the kingdom, but when they seek you in praise and worship, that you will dump down the power of the Holy Spirit, that you will baptize them with fire, with the evidence of speaking in tongues. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Father God, just touch every listener of this radio show. Make them bold. Make them strong. Put a spirit of fearlessness upon them so that they witness to other people and leave none of their friends. None of the people that they meet in the streets unwittingly surprised by the arrival of our King to rescue the bride. And we give you all the praise and honor and glory, Father God. Amen. Thank you for joining us tonight. God bless you.